Happy 4th of July.
Happy 4th.
Happy 4th.
Thank you.
Welcome to our third annual recitation of the Declaration of Independence event. This program is hosted by the North Andover Historical Society and the Friends of the 1836 Meeting House, with financial support from Mass Humanities and organizational support from the North Andover Festival Committee. I'm John Lenhoff, the event coordinator and a board member for the Friends of the 1836 Meeting House. We're here to celebrate our nation's founding and the signing of the Declaration of Independence by activist patriots on July 4th, 1776. Today we will hear our state reps, Trom Wynn and Christina Minicucci, read the Declaration of Independence, and then listen to other speeches from our nation's history. Today's speakers will recite these historic words much in the same way that news and opinion was delivered on town commons across early America. These speeches are all original text and edited only for length. In addition to the Declaration of Independence, we have selected historic speeches that highlight the struggle for racial justice and women's rights throughout American history. Indeed, defining freedom resonates across many of today's conflicts for equity and justice. Behind every stride forward for civil rights were individuals who swayed opinions, demanded equality, and inspired people. Often they did this through a series of speeches. The revolutionary words you will hear today were written by U.S. Presidents Thomas Jefferson, Abraham Lincoln, and Lyndon Johnson, and by activist patriots Frederick Douglass, Susan B. Anthony, and Martin Luther King Jr. We offer these historic readings to both celebrate and reflect upon our nation's past. In primary schools, we were told that the early settlers of America were people fleeing difficult lives in Britain, Ireland, Scotland, or Germany, that they came to America for religious freedom and to escape poverty, warfare, political turmoil, famine, and disease. They believed colonial life offered new opportunities. Often untold is that the immigration of European settlers to this land was emboldened by the papal decree known as the Doctrine of Discovery of 1493. The doctrine established a spiritual, political, and legal justification for colonization and seizure of lands not inhabited by Christians. I quote from the doctrine, that in our times the Christian religion be exalted and be everywhere increased and spread, that the health for souls cared for, and that barbarous nations be overthrown and brought to the faith itself, end quote. The doctrine of discovery justified the often violent and brutal displacement of native peoples to enable the European settlement of land that became America. As part of our recognition of today's Independence Day, we'd like to introduce you to the concept of a land acknowledgement. This segment of our program was written by Alex Bass as part of his middle school civics project with the encouragement of his teacher, Mr. McGrady. Alex writes, a land acknowledgement is a respectful way to honor the peoples indigenous to the land we live on. It acknowledges the original stewards of this land and how they, through colonization, were unjustly removed from their lands. A land acknowledgement helps us begin to learn about Native American history, which is part of our shared American history. In learning our true shared history, we also learn that indigenous peoples have made many important contributions to our society and democracy and continue to do so today. Implementing a land acknowledgement is a crucial step in creating a more knowledgeable and equitable society. So Alex Bass will read his land acknowledgement. He is a student at North Andover High School. He just finished a year learning about civics in action at the North Andover Middle School. The main issue of his student-led civics project that he personally selected was to craft a land acknowledgement and now work to include it as a procedural element for town meetings and events. Through his work and with the full support of his civics teacher, Mr. McGravy, Alex is here today to publicly read this message that he crafted based on detailed research as well as civic advocacy with members of his community.
As we gather here today, we respectfully acknowledge the town of North Andover's presence on the traditional lands of the Penacook, Pawtucket, and Pawtucket Nations. As the original stewards of this land, they lived with great respect for the land and for each other for all countless generations before the onslaught of colonization, genocide, and forced removal. We honor all indigenous peoples who lived on this land before colonization, who live here today, and all future generations. We pledge to learn the true history of the indigenous peoples of this land and support and listen to indigenous voices and communities today to promote respect, equity, and justice. We also acknowledge the many contributions indigenous peoples have made to our society and pledge to learn from indigenous cultures to honor and respect the land and all peoples.
Thank you, Alex. Before we continue with our readings, Rockwood Taylor will perform their medley, I Hear Them All, This Land Is Your Land. I Hear Them All was written in 2006 by Ketch Secor and Dave Rawlings of Old Crow Medicine Show. Ketch said, I Hear Them All is a song about listening. It's a song about listening with a kind of collective ear to all of the sounds that humanity is making. As part of this medley, you will hear new verses from Woody Guthrie's This Land Is Your Land, originally written in 1940 in response to Woody hearing God Bless America. Our version today includes two long-lost verses written by Guthrie. A Smithsonian archivist uncovered the lost verses in 1997. This medley is part of today's theme of listening to stories about humanity from the land we inhabit. Rockwood Taylor is a genre-fluid acoustic duo consisting of Charlie Rockwood Farr and Lynn Taylor, who tour all over the Northeast and even as far as Nashville and Asheville. They write soul-searching, socially conscious originals, and their 2019 release, Finding Home, was nominated for a New England Music Award for Best Album. You can find them all over the internet, YouTube, Facebook, Spotify, and at rockwoodtaylor.com.
Thank you, John. And thank you all for being here. I feel like this is just what we need on this holiday. And let's get on with it. I hear them all. Deserts where they're wandering, hear them crying out for heaven's own benevolence upon them, hear destructive powers prevailing. I hear fools falsely hailing to the crooked wits of tyrants when they call. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear the sound of tearing pages and the roar of burning paper, all the crimes acquisition turned to air and ash and vapor, and the rattle of the shackle far beyond emancipators, the lowliest to gather in their stalls. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. So while you sit and whistle Dixie with your money and your power, I can hear the flowers grow beneath the rubble of the towers. I hear leaders quit their lying, I hear babies quit their crying. I hear soldiers quit their dying, one and all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. That side was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream waters, this land was made for you and me. In the shadow of the steeple, I see my people. I'm marching in the streets, I see my people, and they stand there hurting. I stand here asking, well, is this land made for you and me? Sing it with me, people. This land is your land, this land is my land. From California to the New York Island, from the Redwood Forest to the Gulf Stream World. This land was made for you and me. Nobody living can ever stop me. As I go walking that freedom highway, nobody living can ever make me turn back. Because this land was made for you and me. This land is your land, this land is my land. From Zion, I hear Noah's waterfall. I hear the gentle lamb of Judah sleeping at the feet of Buddha and the prophets, from Elijah to the old Paiute Wovoka, take their places at the table when they're called. And I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all. I hear them all, I hear them all, I hear them all.
Thank you, Charlie and Lynn. So today is the 246th anniversary of the signing of the Declaration of Independence. This signing took place 286 years after the Doctrine of Discovery was issued. The Declaration of Independence states, "We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness." The United States Declaration of Independence is the pronouncement of revolution against the oppressor British government by the 56 activist patriots of the Second Continental Congress, meeting at the Pennsylvania State House in Philadelphia on July 4, 1776. The Continental Congress was composed exclusively of white male landowners, since they were the only segment of the population that was allowed to vote at the time. The principal author was 33-year-old Thomas Jefferson. The text went through 86 versions within committee and before being approved by the Continental Congress. At the most basic level, the Declaration of Independence is a list of grievances against the British Crown, seeking the sympathy of the international community for the cause of the colonies and revolting against their mother country. But at a higher level, the ideas expressed in the Declaration serves as the inspiration for American democratic values. These ideas that all men are created equal and that government is based on the consent of the governed became the foundation for the U.S. political ideal of popular sovereignty. That the government exists to serve the people who elect representatives to express their will. Before I introduce our readers, our state reps, Tom Wynn and Christina Minicucci, I wanted to point out that Senator Barry Feingold is somewhere in the audience. Let's say hello to him. And I'd also like to introduce Virginia Lee, who's running for Essex County Sheriff. Stop by and say hello to both of them and hear what they have to say. So now, I'd like to introduce Tram Nguyen. She is the state representative for the 18th Essex District, which includes parts of Andover, Boxford, North Andover, and Tewksbury. She's a first-generation Vietnamese-American immigrant, the first person in her family to graduate from college and law school, and the first Vietnamese-American woman to be elected to public office in Massachusetts. Christina Minicucci is the state rep for the 14th Essex District, which includes parts of Haverhill, Lawrence, Methuen, and North Andover. She was born in Lawrence and resides with her husband and three children in North Andover.
The unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitled them. A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, and accordingly all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty, to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having indirect object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to a candid world.
He has refused to assent to laws, the most wholesome and necessary for the public good. He has refused to pass other laws for the accommodation of large districts of people unless those people would relinquish the right of representation in the legislature, a right inestimable to them and formidable to tyrants only. He has endeavored to prevent the population of these states for that purpose obstructing the laws for naturalization of foreigners, refusing to pass others to encourage their migrations hither, and raising the conditions of new appropriations of lands. He has made judges dependent on his will alone for the tenure of their offices and the amount and payment of their salaries. He has erected a multitude of new offices and sent hither swarms of officers to harass our people and eat out their substance. He has kept among us, in times of peace, standing armies without the consent of our legislature. He has affected to render the military independent and superior to the civil power. He has combined with others to subject us to a jurisdiction foreign to our Constitution and unacknowledged by our laws, giving his assent to their acts of pretended legislation, for quartering large bodies of armed troops among us, for protecting them by a mock trial from punishment for any murders which they should commit on the inhabitants of these states,
for cutting off our trade with all parts of the world, for imposing taxes on us without our consent, for depriving us in many cases of the benefits of trial by jury, for transporting us beyond seas to be tried for pretended offenses, for taking away our charters, abolishing our most valuable laws, in altering fundamentally the forms of our government, for suspending our own legislatures and declaring themselves invested with power to legislate for us in all cases whatsoever. He has abdicated government here by declaring us out of his protection and waging war against us. He has plundered our seas, ravaged our coasts, burnt our towns, and destroyed the lives of our people. He is at this time transporting large armies of foreign mercenaries to complete the works of death, desolation, and tyranny, already begun with circumstances of cruelty and perfidy scarcely paralleled in the most barbarous ages and totally unworthy the head of a civilized nation.
In every stage of these oppressions, we have petitioned for redress in the most humble terms. Our repeated petitions have been answered only by repeated injury. A prince whose character is thus marked by every act which may define a tyrant is unfit to be the ruler of a free people.
Nor have we been wanting in attentions to our British brethren. We have warned them from time to time of attempts by their legislature to extend an unwarrantable jurisdiction over us. We have reminded them of the circumstances of our migration and settlement here. We have appealed to their native justice and magnanimity, and we have conjured them by the ties of our common kindred to disavow these usurpations, which would inevitably interrupt our connections and correspondence. They too have been deaf to the voice of justice and of consanguinity. We must, therefore, acquiesce in the necessity which denounces our separation and hold them, as we hold the rest of mankind, enemies in war, in peace friends.
We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America in General Congress assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions due in the name and by authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the great state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
Thank you, Tran and Christina. The Declaration of Independence announced that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Our next speech is from 1852, exactly 76 years after the Declaration of Independence, and it's entitled, What to the Slave is the Fourth of July, written by Frederick Douglass. In his speech, Douglass asks, Are the great principles of political freedom and of natural justice embodied in that Declaration of Independence extended to us? Douglass was an American social reformer, abolitionist, orator, writer, and statesman. After escaping from slavery in Maryland, Douglass became a national leader of the abolitionist movement in Massachusetts and New York, becoming famous for his oratory and incisive anti-slavery writings. Accordingly, he was described by abolitionists in his time as a living counterexample to slaveholders' arguments that enslaved people lacked the intellectual capacity to function as independent American citizens. He had been invited to speak about what the 4th of July means for America's black population at an event commemorating the signing of the Declaration of Independence held at Rochester, New York's Corinthian Hall on July 5, 1852. Douglass tells the audience, The rich inheritance of justice, liberty, prosperity, and independence bequeathed by your fathers is shared by you, not by me. There were approximately 500 attendees who heard him speak, each paying 12.5 cents. Joey Cotwright will read excerpts from the Douglass speech. He is an Afro-Puerto Rican poet, educator, activist, and ally to the empowerment of BIPOC and youth communities.
My president, friends, and fellow citizens. The papers and placards say that I am to deliver a 4th of July oration. This certainly sounds large and out of the common way for me. The fact is, ladies and gentlemen, the distance between this platform and the slave plantation from which I escaped is considerable, and the difficulties to be overcome in getting from the latter to the former are by no means slight. That I am here today, to me, is a matter of astonishment as well as of gratitude. Fellow citizens, pardon me. Allow me to ask, why am I called upon to speak here today? What have I or those I represent to do with your national independence? After the great principles of political freedom and natural justice embodied in that Declaration of Independence, are they extended to us? Am I therefore called upon to bring our humble offering to this national altar and to confess the benefits and express devout gratitude for the blessings resulting from your independence to us? I am not included within the pale of this glorious anniversary. Your independence only reveals the immeasurable distance between us. The blessings in which you this day rejoice are not enjoyed in common. The rich inheritance of justice, liberty, prosperity, and independence bequeathed by your fathers is shared by you, not by me. The sunlight that brought life and healing to you has brought stripes and death to me. This 4th of July is yours. Not mine. You may rejoice, I must mourn. To drag a man in fetters into the grand illuminated temple of liberty and call upon him to join you in joyous anthems were inhuman mockery and sacrilegious irony. Do you mean, citizens, to mock me? Asking me to speak today? What to the American slave is your 4th of July? I answer, a day that reveals to him more than other days of the year the gross injustice and cruelty to which he is a constant victim. To him, your celebration is a sham. Your boasted liberty an unholy license, your national greatness swelling vanity. Your sounds of rejoicing and empty are heartless. Your denunciation of tyrants, brass-fronted impudence. Your shouts of liberty and equality are hollow mockery. Your prayers and hymns, your sermons and thanksgivings with all of your religious parade and solemnity are to him more bombast, fraud, deception, impiety, and hypocrisy. A thin veil to cover up crimes that would disgrace a nation of savages. There is not a nation on earth guilty of practices more shocking and bloody than are the peoples of these United States at this very hour. At times like this, scorching irony, not convincing argument is needed. Oh, had I the ability to reach the nation's ear, I would today put forth a stream of fiery, biting ridicule, blasting reproach, withering sarcasm, and stern rebuke. For it is not light that is needed, but fire. It is not the gentle shower, but thunder. We need the storm, the whirlwind, the earthquake. The feeling of a nation must be quickened. The consciousness of the nation must be roused. The propriety of the nation must be startled. The hypocrisy of the nation must be exposed. And the crimes against God and man must be proclaimed and denounced. Thank you.
I'm going to sing a song that I wrote. All of that good advice. Hope you enjoy it.
Chelsea. We just heard the spiritual Let Freedom Ring, an original song by Chelsea Ward. Chelsea's the lead singer of Saranigami. She is originally from Louisiana. She loves singing and creating, and she draws inspiration for her original songs from her life experiences and from the hopes and dreams that she would like to manifest in this lifetime. She also likes glitter. While running for election to the Senate in 1858, Abraham Lincoln said, "I should like to know if taking this old Declaration of Independence, which declares that all men are equal upon principle, and making exceptions to it, where will it stop?" The national conflict over freedom and equality, and spoken about by Frederick Douglass in his speech, catalyzed the war between the North and the South. This civil war resulted in the loss of 620,000 soldiers, including 40,000 black Union servicemen. 200,000 black soldiers volunteered and served in the Union Army, and 20% of them died as a result of this war. On November 19, 1863, Abraham Lincoln, now president, delivered remarks which later became known as the Gettysburg Address. At the official dedication ceremony for the National Cemetery of Gettysburg in Pennsylvania, on the site of one of the bloodiest and most decisive battles of the Civil War, in it, he invoked principles of human equality contained in the Declaration of Independence and connected the sacrifices of the Civil War with the desire for a new birth of freedom, as well as the all-important preservation of the Union created in 1776 and its ideal of self-government. The main message of the Gettysburg Address is that ideals are worth dying for and that it is up to the living to carry on the work of those who have died to protect ideals. The Gettysburg Address will be read by Mark DeSalvo. Mark DeSalvo is a lifelong active citizen in the North Andover community and currently serves as town moderator. Coincidentally, his daughter Celia graduated from Gettysburg College, where Mark joined her on frequent somber visits to the hallowed ground of the battlefield and the National Cemetery, where President Lincoln gave his rightfully heralded address.
As you've heard, it takes longer to explain what the Gettysburg Address's meaning is than to actually recite it. These are perhaps the most, not perhaps, these are certainly the most eloquent words spoken by any president, a mere 272 words to describe a nation's grief and what their promise was as well.
Turn it up!
I can't hear, Mark. Back there.
Thank you. 67 years ago, our fathers brought forth on this continent a new nation, conceived in liberty and dedicated to the proposition that all men are created equal. Now we are engaged in a great civil war, testing whether that nation, or any nation so conceived and so dedicated, can long endure. We are met on a great battlefield of that war. We have come to dedicate a portion of that field as a final resting place for those who here gave their lives that nation might live. It is altogether fitting and proper that we should do this. But in a larger sense, we cannot dedicate. We cannot consecrate. We cannot hallow this ground. The brave men, living and dead, who struggled here have consecrated it far above our poor power to add or detract. The world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. It is for us, the living, rather to be dedicated here to the unfinished work which they who fought here have thus far so nobly advanced. It is rather for us to be here dedicated to the great task remaining before us, that from these honored dead we take increased devotion to that cause for which they gave the last full measure of devotion. That we here highly resolve that these dead shall not have died in vain. That this nation, under God, shall have a new birth of freedom, and that government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from this earth.
Shokin Farewell, written by Jay Unger in 1982. It became associated with the Civil War when the tune was used as the title theme of the 1990 PBS TV miniseries, The Civil War. Jay Unger describes the song as coming out of a sense of loss and longing, which could very well describe feelings at the end of the Civil War, or really any conflict that exacts a deep toll, a sense of loss and longing. A Shokin Farewell was performed today by Dave Medvitz and Bill Perry. Dave Medvitz on fiddle and Bill Perry on guitar. They've been playing traditional music together for over 40 years. Most recently, they are part of the trio Speed the Plow, an acoustic band based in northeastern Massachusetts. They play at a wide variety of farms, dances, orchards, farmers markets, and special events throughout the region. Check them out at speedtheplow.blog. Conflict in America did not end with the Civil War, and we now shift our program to the suffrage movement. Liberty and justice for all did not extend to women who did not have the right to vote and were denied many other rights held by men. Susan B. Anthony was a prominent leader in the women's rights movement. She, along with Elizabeth Cady Stanton, founded the National Women's Suffrage Association in 1869, which advocated for giving women the right to vote. In 1893, suffragette Frances Harper, a former enslaved woman, said, "So close is the bond between man and women that you cannot raise one without lifting the other." Stanton, Harper, and Anthony, along with the resistance, persistence, and dedication of millions of others, paved the way for Congress' eventual ratification of the 19th Amendment in 1920, which gave women the right to vote. 50 years before the 19th Amendment was passed, Susan B. Anthony voted in the presidential election. 2 weeks later, she was arrested. After her indictment, Anthony gave her famous "Is It a Crime to Vote?" speech that we will hear portions of today. During her trial, Anthony was unable to testify on her behalf since women's testimony was not considered to be competent. Instead, her lawyer presented her arguments. She was convicted of casting an illegal vote and fined $100. Anthony refused to pay the fine, stating, "May I please, Your Honor, I will never pay a dollar of your unjust penalty." Resistance to tyranny is obedience to God. The trial allowed Anthony to disseminate her arguments in support of women's suffrage to a much larger audience. Our reader of Is It a Crime to Vote is Esther Friedman, a representative of Greater Andover Individual, a chapter of the National Grassroots Individual Project. GAI's mission is to demystify activism, provide civic education, and promote civic engagement in order to elect progressive leaders, realize bold progressive policies, and rebuild our democracy. Esther is one of the founding members of North Reading Indivisible and has served on the core leadership team of Greater Andover Indivisible. She's also a therapist, a songwriter, and a fiercely proud American citizen.
I'm very proud to be representing the voice of Susan B. Anthony, who would not pay a dollar, so here goes. Is it a crime to vote? Friends and fellow citizens, I stand before you tonight under indictment for the alleged crime of having voted at the last presidential election without having a lawful right to vote. It shall be my work this evening to prove to you that in thus voting, I not only committed no crime, but instead simply exercised my citizen's right guaranteed to me and all United States citizens by the National Constitution beyond the power of any state to deny. Our democratic republican government is blessed on the idea of the natural right of every individual member thereof to a vote and a voice in making and executing the laws. We assert the province of government to be secure the people in the enjoyment of their unalienable rights. We throw to the winds the old dogma that governments can give rights. Before governments were organized, no one denied that each individual possessed the right to protect his own life, liberty, and property. And when 100 or 1,000 people enter into a free government, they do not barter away their natural rights. They simply pledge themselves to protect each other in the enjoyment of them. Through prescribed judicial and legislative tribunals, they agree to abandon the methods of brute force in the adjustment of their differences and adopt those of civilization. Surely the right of the whole people to vote is here clearly implied. For however destructive in their happiness this government might become, a disenfranchised class could neither alter nor abolish it, nor institute a new one, except by the old brute force method of insurrection and rebellion. One half of the people of this nation today are utterly powerless to blot from the statute books an unjust law to write, a new and just one. The women, dissatisfied as they are with this form of government that enforces taxation without representation, that compels them to obey laws that they have never given their consent to, that imprisons and hangs them without a trial by a jury of their peers, that robs them in marriage of the custody of their own persons, wages, and children, are this half of the people left wholly at the mercy of the other half, in direct violation of the spirit and the letter of the declarations of the framers of this government, every one of which was based on the immutable principle of equal rights to all. It was we, the people, not we, the white male citizens, nor yet we, the male citizens, but we, the whole people, who formed this union. And we formed it not to give the blessings of or liberty, but to secure them. Not to half of ourselves and the half of our posterity, but to the whole people, women as well as men. And it is downright mockery to talk to women of their enjoyment of the blessings of liberty while they are denied the use of the only means of securing them provided by this democratic Republican government, the ballot. What I ask you is the distinct difference between the inhabitants of a monarchy and those of a republican form of government. In the monarchy, the people are subjects, helpless, powerless, bound to obey laws made by superiors, while in the republic, the people are citizens, individuals, sovereigns, all clothed with equal power to make and unmake both their laws and the lawmakers. And the moment you deprive a person of his right to a voice in government, you degrade him from the status of a citizen of the republic to that of a subject. He is a powerless subject, serf or slave, not a free and independent citizen in any sense. We no longer petition legislature or Congress to give us the right to vote. We appeal to the women everywhere to exercise their too long neglected citizens' right to vote. We appeal to the inspectors of every election everywhere to receive the votes of all United States citizens, as it is their duty to do. We appeal to the United States commissioners and marshals to arrest the inspectors who reject the names and votes of United States citizens, as it is their duty to do, and leave those alone who, like our Eighth Ward inspectors, perform their duties faithfully and well. We ask the juries to fail to return verdicts of quote-unquote guilty against honest, law-abiding, tax-paying citizens for offering their votes at our elections, or against intellectual young men, inspectors of elections, for receiving and counting such citizen votes. We ask the judges to render true and unprejudiced opinions of the law, and wherever there is room for doubt, to give its benefit to the side of liberty and equal rights to women, remembering that the true rule of interpretation under our national constitution, especially since its amendments, is that anything for human rights is constitutional. Everything against human rights, unconstitutional. Thank you. Go Susan B. Anthony. And it is on this line that we propose to fight our battle for the battle all peaceably, but nevertheless, persistently, through to complete triumph when all United States citizens shall be recognized as equals before the law.
Thank you, Esther. We'll now hear Rockwood Taylor return to the stage to perform Sam Cooke's A Change Is Gonna Come. Released in 1964, the song was inspired by various events in Cooke's life, most prominently when he and his entourage were turned away from a whites-only motel in Louisiana. Cooke felt compelled to write a song that spoke to his struggle and of those around him. The song became an anthem for change in the civil rights movement.
And Martin Luther King once said, "The arc of the universe is long, but it bends towards justice." And this is what we must not forget. We must remember, we must keep working, fighting, doing what we can to make sure that the promise that this nation set forth will be for all people.
Change, 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 change.
people. Keep the faith.
Wow. Thank you, Lynn and Charlie.
Whoa.
So Sam Cooke wrote, "Oh, there have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I am able to carry on." We turn our program to the mid-20th century, when Black Americans had more than enough prejudice, injustice, and violence against them. They, along with millions of supporters, mobilized and began an unprecedented fight for civil rights, equality, and equity that continues today. The speech we're about to hear excerpts from was a defining moment of the civil rights movement and among the most iconic speeches in American history. The speech was written and delivered by American Christian minister and civil rights activist, Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., entitled "I Have a Dream." On August 28, 1963, 187 years after the Declaration of Independence put into writing that all men are created equal, a 34-year-old Martin Luther King climbed the marble steps of the Lincoln Memorial in Washington, D.C. to describe his vision of America to over 250,000 supporters. He gave the speech during the March on Washington for Jobs and Freedom. In the speech, he called for civil and economic rights and an end to racism in the United States. Mr. Ralph Bledsoe will perform excerpts of this speech, which he has given in all four corners of Massachusetts over the last 20 years. He is active in our community as a physics and chemistry teacher at Andover High School and chair of the Elections and Nominations Committee for the Andover Education Association. Mr. Bledsoe is also vice chair of the Andover Council on Aging for the Robb Center, Andover Elder Services, as well as clerk for Andover Baptist Church. He was honored in 2020 by the Massachusetts State House Black and Latino Legislative Caucus at the Black Excellence on the Hill event.
Five score years ago, a great American in whose symbolic shadow we stand today signed the Emancipation Proclamation. This momentous decree came as a great beacon light of hope to millions of Negro slaves who had been seared in the flames of withering injustice. It came as a joyous daybreak to end the long night of their captivity. But 159 years later, the Negro still is not free. 159 years later, the life of the Negro is still sadly crippled by the manacles of segregation and the chains of discrimination. 159 years later, the Negro lives on a lonely island of poverty in the midst of a vast ocean of material prosperity. 159 years later, the Negro is still languished in the corners of American society and finds herself in exile in her own land. So we've come here today to dramatize this shameful condition. I say to you today, my friends, that even though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. It is a dream deeply rooted in the American dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up, live out the true meaning of its creed, We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men and women are created equal. I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the daughters of former slaves and the daughters of former slave owners will be able to sit down together at the table of sisterhood. I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today. I have a dream that one day down in Alabama, with its vicious racists, with its governor having his lips dripping with the words of interposition and nullification, one day right there, little black girls and black boys will join hands with little white girls and white boys as sisters and brothers. I have a dream today. I have a dream that every valley should be exalted, that every hill and mountain should be made low, the rough places plain, and the crooked places straight, and the glory of the Lord should be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day. This will be the day when all of God's children will be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, 'tis of thee. Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my mothers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring." And if America is to become a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring from the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire. Let freedom ring from the mighty mountains of New York. Let freedom ring from the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania. Let freedom ring from the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado. Let freedom ring from the curvaceous slopes of California. But not only that, let freedom ring from Stone Mountain of Georgia. Let freedom ring from Lookout Mountain of Tennessee. Let freedom ring from every hill and molehill of Mississippi. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we let freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's children, black women and white women, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, "Free at last, free at last, thank God Almighty, we are free at last."
Thank you, Ralph. We will now hear Bill Putnam and John Chang performing a song made famous by the Youngbloods called "Get Together." The song "Get Together" was written in the mid-60s and is an appeal for peace and brotherhood, presenting the polarity of love versus fear and the choice to be made between them. Bill and John are members of the White Street Band, which, by the way, will be performing here on the North Andover Common on Sunday, August 7th at 6 p.m. as part of the Concerts on the Common series. So come back and see them.
song we sing. Here's the way we die. You can make the mountains ring, or make the angels cry. Oh, the bird is on the wing, and you may not know why. Come on, people now, smile on your brother. Everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Some may come and some may go, we will surely pass. When the one who left us here returns for us at last, we are the moment's sunlight fading in the grass. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now. Come on, people now, smile on your brother, everybody get together, try to love one another right now.
Thank you, Bill and John, singing about everybody getting together. In the 1960s, the political pressure of nationwide protests brought about change, though there was resistance. In 1964, Congress passed the Civil Rights Act, which ended segregation in public places and banned employment discrimination on the basis of race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. The final vote was 290 to 130 in the House of Representatives, and after a 54-day Senate filibuster, voting was 73 to 27. The Civil Rights Act did little to address the rampant discrimination in voting rights, so on March 15th, 1965, President Lyndon Johnson addressed a joint session of Congress to urge the passage of legislation guaranteeing voting rights for all, including banning poll taxes and literacy tests and other barriers to black voting. His address was broadcast live on national TV. Using the phrase, "We shall overcome," borrowed from African-American leaders struggling for equal rights, Johnson declared that every American citizen must have an equal right to vote. Johnson reminded the nation that the 15th Amendment, which was passed in 1870, gave all citizens the right to vote regardless of race or color. But states had defied the Constitution and erected barriers. Discrimination had taken the form of literacy, knowledge, or character tests administered solely to African Americans to keep them from registering to vote. The speech was delivered 8 days after racial violence erupted in Selma, Alabama. Civil rights leader John Lewis and over 500 marchers were attacked while planning a march from Selma to Montgomery to register African Americans to vote. The police violence that erupted resulted in the death of a King supporter, James J. Reeb, a white Unitarian minister from Boston. Reverend Reeb preached in North Parish Church just a few weeks before heading to Selma, right over there. Television news coverage of the event galvanized voting rights supporters in Congress. The House passed the Voting Rights Act by 333-85 vote, and the Senate passed it 77-19. Here to read portions of LBJ's voting rights speech is Joshua Alba. Josh is a first-generation Dominican American who's been an activist and organizer on public education, racial and economic justice issues in Lawrence for over a decade. He is in his second term as a Lawrence School Committee member, where he is helping in the fight to return management of Lawrence Public Schools to the people of Lawrence and away from the state takeover.
It's really hard to be up here today. Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, members of the Congress, I speak tonight for the dignity of men and the destiny of democracy. I urge every member of both parties, Americans of all religions and of all colors, from every section of this country to join me in that cause. At times, history and fate meet at a single time and a single place to shape a turning point in man's unending search for freedom. So it was at Lexington and Concord. So it was a century ago at Appomattox. So it was last week in Selma, Alabama. There, long-suffering men and women peacefully protested the denial of their rights as Americans. Many were brutally assaulted. One good man, a man of God, was killed. There is no cause for pride in what has happened in Selma. There is no cause for self-satisfaction in the long denial of equal rights of millions of Americans. But there is cause for hope and for faith in our democracy in what is happening here tonight. For the cries of pain and the hymns and protests of oppressed people have summoned into convocation all the majesty of this great government, the government of the greatest nation on earth. Highly questionable. Our mission is at once the oldest and most basic of this country, to right wrong, to do justice, to serve men. In our time, we have come to live with moments of great crisis. Our lives have been marked with debate about great issues. Issues of war and peace, issues of prosperity and depression, but rarely in any time does any issue lay bare the secret heart of America itself, like today. Rarely are we met with a challenge, not to our growth or abundance, our welfare or our security, but rather to the values and the purposes of the meaning and the meaning of our beloved nation. The issue of equal rights for American Negroes is such an issue, and should we defeat every enemy, should we double our wealth and conquer the stars, should we and still be unequal to this issue, then we will have failed as a people and as a nation. This was the first nation in the history of the world to be founded with a purpose. The great phrases of that purpose still sound in every American heart, North and South. All men are created equal, government by the consent of the governed. Give me liberty or give me death. Well, those are not just clever words, or those are not just empty theories. In their name, Americans have fought and died for two centuries, and tonight around the world, they stand there as guardians of our liberty, risking their lives. Those words are a promise to every citizen that he shall share in the dignity of man. This dignity cannot be found in man's possessions. It cannot be found in his power or in his position. It really rests on his right to be treated as a man equal in opportunity to all others. It says that he shall share in freedom. He shall choose his leaders, educate his children, and provide for his family according to his ability and his merits as a human being. To apply any other test to deny a man his hopes because of his color or race, his religion or place of birth, is not only to do injustice, it is to deny America. And there's a bee on my page and it's beautiful. Is to deny America and to dishonor the dead who gave their lives for American freedom. To those who seek to avoid action by their national government in their own communities, who seek to maintain purely local control over elections, the answer is simple. Open your polling places to all your people. Allow men and women to register and vote whatever the color of their skin. Extend the rights of citizenship to every citizen on the land. But even if we pass this bill, the battle will not be over. What happened in Selma is part of a far larger movement which reaches into every section and state of America. It is the effort of American Negroes to secure for themselves the full blessing of American life. Their cause must be our cause too, because it is not just Negroes, but really it is all of us who must overcome the crippling legacy of bigotry and injustice. Amen. We shall overcome.
As we close our program, I want to thank all our speakers for participating today. Your work on behalf of all members of our community is an inspiration. Thank you. I want to thank all those who brought their beautiful voices and instruments to our program, and also to our sound engineer, Leo. Thank you, Sean, for video recording today and your editing effort this week are gratefully acknowledged.
Go, Sean, go!
You can find Sean's video of today's event on the Friends of the 1836 Meeting House website in a few days. Tomorrow afternoon, right, Sean?
Yeah.
Also, thank you to North Andover CAM. They provided all the equipment that we're using today. And a few more things. I want to thank the Festival Committee and Jeff Coco for their help and support. It makes it easier to appear on our common with the Festival Committee behind this. And Mass Humanities provided financial support through their Reading Frederick Douglass Together grant. And so there was some money to work with today. That's gratefully acknowledged. And I certainly want to thank our audience today. Appreciate you joining us. We look forward to seeing you next year. And go out there and make some good trouble. We opened today's program by reading our nation's founding document that stated all men are created equal. This principle is forever linked to the Declaration of Independence. The United States was in 1776 and remains today the only nation in the world founded on a principle. And we rise and fall by our fidelity to that principle. And as we close today's event, I'll read a quote from Abraham Lincoln, taken from his first inaugural address in 1861. Desperately wishing to avoid civil war, Lincoln ended his address with this plea. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic chords of memory will swell when again touched, and surely they will be by the better angels of our nature. Our final musical performance bring Bill Putnam and John Chang back to the stage, and then Chelsea Ward is going to close as well. So John and Bill will sing Let's Work Together, which was made famous by Canned Heat. It was written in the mid-60s and was intended to provide a message of unity aimed at a nation rife with conflict over the civil rights movement in the Vietnam War. After their performance, Chelsea Ward will return and she'll sing My Love Song. It's an original piece and she'll introduce it to you. Again, thank you for joining us today, and go out there and make some good trouble.
Someone happy. How's everybody doing? How's everybody feeling? Good, I hope. So this is a song called My Love Song. It is a love song that I wrote for myself. And I think in hearing a lot of what, yes, self-love, self-care, we love to see it. I think in hearing the message that John shared, I think they were excerpts from a speech, just the importance of working together and also just like acknowledgement of ourselves as divine beings and just like loving ourselves and our angelic nature. And I think that's really powerful and beautiful. So I hope you all enjoy that. So I'll write myself a love song. And long I've been so free. Night is long, so I'll write myself a love song. And I love you, I love me, I love you. For there are moons, there are suns, there are skies in the sea. There are shells that I love, and there's wings flying free. For there's an angel in my heart that seems to have fallen for me. And I love you, I love me, I love you. There's me, myself, and I don't need a reason nor why. Only peace that I feel when I sing. Well, there's an angel in my heart that flutters when I breathe. And I love you, I love me, I love me. If I wait for the change, when will it come? If I hold off on love, I won't feel the warmth of my sun. Well, there's an angel in my heart with a kiss just for me. And I love you, I love me, I love you. Well, there's an angel in my heart with a kiss just for me. And I love you, I love me, I love you. There's an angel in my heart with a kiss just for me. And I love you, I love me, I love you.